So my talk is related to computer-aided molecular design, and I'm going to talk about mostly the applications where you can get environmentally friendly separations. Okay, so we all know why we want to look at environmentally friendly thing, and in fact, here even the chimpanzees are saying that we need to worry about environment before even we can evolve. So one of the things what I want to emphasize is that material design or computer-aided molecular design is very important in many industries as well as areas. Especially you want to find materials with the desired properties, whether it's physical properties, chemical property, biological or health properties. So for the applications you are looking for. So it is important in various industries as well as various disciplines. And essentially what people use the approaches to material design is either doing experiments with different chemicals or materials to find the right property material, or you could have database searches to find the right material. So even getting drugs, you need to find the right drugs. It involves computer, it involves molecular design. And the third approach is a computer-aided molecular design. So the computer-aided molecular design problems where the way we handle it is slightly different from the drug design problem, but it involves the same techniques and approaches. So the way computer-aided molecular design used in designing chemicals is that instead of looking at molecules or atoms, molecules are consisting of atoms, what we look at is, can we actually classify groups of atoms having the same properties? So what we are saying is that each group is contributing to the molecule the same property. And once you can identify a group and from it can be present in one chemical or other, it should contribute to the same extent. If we can do that and develop a method, then you can essentially group contribution methods can divide the molecules into group and it can find the property from those groups for the complete molecule. The reverse problem is that if I specify properties which I want, I should be able to find the molecules or the groups, so the molecules, okay? The essential element why we look at groups is so that the combinatorial explosion of, if you consider atomic level information, it becomes a very large problem, which is really computationally not feasible to solve many times. So what group contribution does is that it identifies groups. So here it identified the three groups, CH3, CH2OH, to form a molecule. And I can predict the properties of CH3, CH2OH from CH3, CH2, and OH contributions. And reversely, I can use that to design new molecules. It essentially becomes a problem, and especially a difficult problem called combinatorial optimization problem, because it involves decisions like what molecules. It's an integer decision, and which is a difficult problem in optimization. Many of these methods, group contribution methods, are not exactly completely accurate. So it involves errors. So it actually has uncertainties, okay? The three examples I'm thinking about giving in this talk is that one problem from a chemical industry where they had an environmental problem to be solved, and they wanted to find environmentally friendly molecules to solve the problem. The second case study I'm going to talk about is really useful in drinking water industry, because If you remember, some time back, there was a lot of hue and cry in Bangladesh about the tube wells, which are actually bringing up arsenic in water. So the second problem is, how do you separate arsenic from water? And the third problem is related to the recent fracking boom, where the fracking water is bringing up a lot of radioactive material in water, and essentially that can be a big problem. Okay, so these are the three things I will be talking about. Essentially, why I gave the title as separations, because essentially there are a lot of common separation techniques in various industries used or in real life. There is absorption, which actually uses absorbents to separate materials. There is adsorption, needs adsorbents, which is a solid liquid or solid gas phenomena. Crystallization is also, it needs solvent, again solid liquid and solid phenomena. Distillation is a liquid gas phenomena. It may need solvents, and that's one of the things. Extraction needs solvents, which is again, so, and there are other material processes which can actually use this approach. So for example, in the last talk, we talked about ionic liquids for sensors. So essentially you can design new ionic liquids to get sensor material which you want. And also there are things like in semiconductor industries, most of the things is done by atomic layer deposition. So can you find a good precursor to do atomic layer deposition? Again, it's a solid process. Many times, as they say, God doesn't like solids, because many of the methods are not developed for solids. So I will talk about that, how we developed a new group contribution method for solids and then to computer-aided molecular design. So the first example is coming from chemical industry. Eastman Chemical, as you all know, Eastman Kodak was a big company. Now it is separated from, it's Eastman and Kodak separate, but essentially Eastman Chemical manufactures a lot of chemicals and essentially involves chemical separation. So they had a problem where their processes was generating acetic acid. Acetic acid and water, and essentially they wanted to not have acetic acid in water, which is going as a wastewater. So they designed a process where they use distillation and extraction. Extraction was the process where they will separate out water from acetic acid by adding a solvent, environmentally benign solvent, and then actually then recover this solvent by distillation. So it had two steps, solvent selection and solvent recycling. And they had designed the process using existing solvents, but if their feed composition was changing, which happens in industry because it may not remain constant, and they were getting a lot of acetic acid in the wastewater, and that was an environmental problem. We looked at their design and found that you cannot change the design much, because essentially it's was a perfect design for the perfect situation. But if the situation changed, essentially that was giving problem, and that's where we concentrated on solvents. So what was the problem? That you want to find the solvent which is also environmentally benign. So if the solvent ends up somewhere in the aqueous space, it shouldn't matter. And the separation should be as good as possible. The thing was, given their feed composition is changing, they also wanted to have flexibility in the face of this change, this uncertainty, this variability. So they didn't want just the yield, they wanted flexibility, they also wanted less environmental impact. So this was the problem where they had objectives like solvent recovery, flexibility, and LC50, LD50 values. So distillation and extraction is very well studied. And as I said, it doesn't involve solids. So the group contribution methods are well designed. So what was the problem? The problem was essentially you use the criteria of distribution coefficient between the one phase versus other to maximize the distribution, so that distribution coefficient, so that your solvent your recovery is highest. You also have solvent selectivity, solvent loss, boiling point, etc. And as I said, the methods, thermodynamic methods, the group contribution method based on thermodynamics is well developed. It is based on what we call it activity coefficient, and it is a function of groups. So when we wrote the problem was, I want to maximize, and don't look at the equations, essentially you can see that you want to maximize distribution coefficient. Essentially, it involves uncertainties also, because there are two things. One is thermodynamically, the group contribution method has errors, so you have to consider that. You have to consider solvent selectivity, solvent light, and you have to consider number of groups and group indexes, which are integer numbers. You, on the other hand, you also have, apart from this, you have to consider a highly nonlinear group contribution method based on for gamma infinity or the group activity coefficient, which is based on thermodynamics. So it becomes a problem of stochastic mixed integer, because you have some continuous decision variable, real decision variable, you have integer decision variable, and you have uncertainty. On the top of that, you're not considering single objective. You have multiple objective. You want to increase the yield, you have to increase the flexibility, decrease the environmental impact, and it becomes a highly computationally intensive problem with four computational loops. The first loop is related to the uncertainty analysis, where you can use similar things like Monte Carlo, but we had to design a new sampling technique for this. Then the model about continuous real number, real equations, that's a nonlinear part of the model. You also have integer variables, what groups to choose, how many of them to choose, and then you have multiple objective, and the results should be a trade-off between different objectives or this thing. So what is this multiple objective problem? As I said, we had to design algorithms for each level which are efficient enough. And I'm just going to show one algorithm right now just to show that how we increase the efficiency of this complete framework. So here is a problem of two objective function, maximize Z1. And I've taken this as a two variable problem just to show graphically. And I also want to maximize C2. They are different objective functions. As you say, the equations are different. And essentially, the feasible surface is A, B, C, D, E. I shouldn't go beyond A, B, C, D, E, because that's not feasible. So I want to find the objective surface which is trade-off between Z1 and Z2. So essentially, what I'm saying is that if I should, and the trade-off surface is this CDE. What does CDE means? That if I look at point C has maximum Z1, but minimum Z2. So, and if I compare point C to point D, you will see that C has better Z1, but D has better Z2. So I cannot say that I can eliminate this thing. But if I compare point B versus C, B is bad in Z1 as compared to C and bad in Z2 as compared to C. So I can eliminate point B. So I can eliminate all the points below this blue line, but I cannot say which one is better in this blue line, and that is a trade-off surface. So essentially what I'm saying is that I want to go get this trade-off surface so decision makers can make this decision. In general, to solve this problem, what people do can combine the objectives, omega 1 and omega 2. But to get this complete line, there are infinite solutions. And essentially, you have to solve problems from W1 is equal to plus infinity to W2 is equal to plus infinity. And in general, that is not possible. So I remember I am an engineer. So I remember a joke between a mathematician and engineer. Mathematician and an engineer graduate student walk in the room and they see a beautiful woman sitting at the end of the room. And they wanted, both of them want to ask her out. And her father comes from behind and says, "Well, you can ask my girl out, but if you take one step, the next step should be half towards her, and then you can ask her out." So mathematician goes, "Oh, first step is x, next step is half x, third step is 1/4 x. I'll have to take infinite steps to reach her, so that's not a solvable problem." But engineer starts walking towards it, and then so the mathematician asks him, "Why are you doing this? You know that infinite step." He said, "No, I am an engineer. If I reach her within a tolerance, that should be acceptable." So that's what happened. So we designed a new algorithm, essentially, which the number of optimization problems solved reduced to 100 or 150 instead of infinite by this method. It's called MinSOOP, minimization of single objective optimization problems to be solved algorithm, MinSOOP algorithm. So similarly, we had designed algorithms at each level to solve a large scale problem. Why I say large scale is will be obvious to you from this Eastman problem. So again, the Eastman problem, I want to find a solvent, a molecule which is environmentally benign, but can give me separation as desired, which should have flexibility, recovery, and other things. So if you look at this problem, it's very important when you're thinking about environmentally benign, that means I shouldn't have groups which can cause problems later. So that's why if you look at the groups which are selected here, we have different groups put here, and there are 24 groups. There are more than 24 groups in possible, but many of them can be aromatic groups, and aromatic groups cause environmental problems, so which are eliminated from this thing. So even if we just take 24 groups and we can say, okay, each group can be up to 10, each group added can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 0 kind of thing. The size of the problem grows to 6.3 into 10 to the power 13. Okay. So as the groups change, it exponentially increases the number of problems to be solved, the integer problem. And there are nonlinearities. So it becomes a large problem. That's why we needed all this algorithmic development. We could solve this problem. We also, given that this group contribution method is studied well, thermodynamic uncertainties were known, and essentially we solved this problem, but we could only give 4 trade-off solutions for the management to decide. And these trade-off solutions can change if their variation in the field changes. So if uncertainties change, they may have to consider different alternatives. What does it involve? It involved 4 objectives are shown here: recovery, which I want to maximize; environmental impact, I want to minimize with LC50 or LD50, and flexibility, I want to maximize. And these are the things which essentially some of them give better environmental impact, but less recovery, better peer recovery, but less flexibility, but you cannot completely eliminate. And what we found is the solvent, which is common, more common in two solutions, is ethyl acetate. Then you, there, it's ethyl acetate has high recovery and high flexibility, but ethyl acetate can have some of the higher environmental impact also, low, high LC50, low LD50 value, okay? A third solution is isopropyl acetate. Isopropyl acetate actually has lower environment LD50, but high LC50, okay? And one of the solutions is methyl propionate. And so we gave this solution to the industry, and they chose what they wanted, and their process is running properly. With that, I will shift to some of the things as I talked about is in the case study two. You know, case study two is related to, as I said, that the problem of arsenic in drinking water. So arsenic in drinking water is a problem in the world, as you can see from this figure. And in some places, it's very high. So for example, as I told you, in Bangladesh, the arsenic levels are pretty high. It reaches harmful to human beings. So processes are designed to remove arsenic from water, and they are adsorption processes. This involves solids to remove arsenic from water and water becomes purer. These adsorbents, which are available, are currently cheaper adsorbents are clay-based adsorbents, and essentially they do not remove arsenic to the extent you want. So we decided to use computer-aided molecular design. So what it involved is that since it's a solid process, there was no group contribution method developed for this kind of arsenic removal process. So we had to actually develop the group contribution method. We looked at the clay adsorbent currently available, bedelite, zeolite, and zeopolite for arsenic removal. We divided it into groups and essentially use optimization to find the group interaction, okay? Then we use these groups to design new molecules. The new molecules are functional groups where SiO2, Na2O, Fe3O2, and how many of them each are present. That's how we design new adsorbent, okay? And the essential method, the objective was to remove arsenic as high as possible. So we used this, and essentially first we developed the interaction parameters where we wanted to match the experimental values of existing adsorbent to the group contribution method. And you can see that all three adsorbents, it matches well. So we got good interaction parameters. Since we didn't have a large data set, we didn't consider uncertainties in it. And then we tried to design. So these are some of the interaction parameters. And you can see that they are for AS is arsenic here. So then we use maximization of adsorption capacity and designing how many groups are present in each molecule. And so we design, this is again used as a single objective problem. We didn't have multiple objectives, but and we didn't consider uncertainty because we didn't have enough information. So we designed the new molecules, and you can see that here are the 10 base molecules. There is amount adsorbed, percentage adsorbed, and you can see that all of them are adsorbing very high percentage. And we also in the last column, we do weight of the molecule. We want as low volume as possible so that it's cheaper. And you can see that the first adsorbent, the adsorption capacity is 589.5 milligram per gram, which if you look at here in the market what are the adsorbents available for arsenic removal. This is actually order of magnitude higher than the current removal capacity. Okay, so we could do this. Then we also design experiments to check our adsorbent. Essentially, it involves synthesizing a clay mesh in a hydrothermal condition and add groups by precipitating groups on the clay and then evaporate the molecular water and solidify the clay. What we found is that compared to the three adsorbent currently used for arsenic removal, the synthetic adsorbent, which is designed based on computed molecular, is really, really removes arsenic to the large extent, okay? And as I said, it's order of magnitude, this thing. So we can match that with the experiments. The yellow one is the our adsorbent. The third case study is NAM removal from fracking water. Everybody knows fracking. And in United States, there are two areas where fracking is more relevant, in the Barnett Shale, which is near Texas, and in the Marcellus Shale, okay? Essentially, what fracking involves is use large amount of water with some chemicals in it, injected in the well in high force, and essentially gas is released, and there is a water which is a flow back and produce water which is collected, and then wastewater is gone. It's either put in the wells, gas in the oil wells, or disposed of. Unfortunately, because fracking is done at a very deep level in the Earth's crust, lot of radioactive material comes up, and that's called NAM, naturally occurring radioactive material. And this NAM is a big problem. Currently, there are not that many techniques to remove NAM cost effectively. So essentially, as I said, that flow fracturing creates flow back and produce water, and it is contaminated by lot of radioactive material. Okay, and along with radioactive material, there are other impurities. So we again designed the adsorbent to collect NAM. Objective function is NAM remove as much quantity of radium as possible. And we also put constraints on how much radium should remain in this thing. You have different phases, surface phase, adsorbent solution phase, and bulk phase. And you also have thermodynamic models, which are non-linear models. It's just seven as equation, but it's a lot of equations there. And you want to find how each group. Again, we had to design GCM, group contribution method. And so, and we designed and did computed and molecular design. So here is, we design adsorbents for removal of radium and barium together. What we found is that we could find the adsorbents, and here we could find the adsorbent which can remove radium 90% with less amount. But if you increase the amount, you can remove radium almost 99.9%, but barium is not removed that much together. And essentially, you can see that each adsorbent will have different group. If you just consider radium, you can remove radium with very less amount or high amount, almost 99.4%, if you just separate radium. And you can separate barium, also 99%, with a high amount of clay adsorbent. But you can remove separately. So if you remove separately barium and radium, you could have, using different adsorbent, you can actually remove it. I didn't give the type of adsorbent we use because we are patenting this. So in summary, what I presented is an efficient framework for computer-aided molecular design for material or molecular design problem. It can be a multi-objective framework to give trade-offs between objectives, and uncertainties can change design. But from the real-world case studies we produce, we found that we can get better materials either for Eastman Cuddy or arsenic in drinking water or not removal from fracking water. Currently, we are developing CAMD for material processing like atomic layer deposition, crystallization, and other solid processes. There are a number of people contributed, but the main contributors are my students, and here are they now. With that, I want to thank you and answer any questions you have.